Okay. Oh, I have one. So last time we were talking about antiderivative, which is the procedure that undoes derivative. So just to recap that a little bit, we know the following antiderivatives. We know the antiderivative of x to n dx. So what is this? Very good. X to n plus 1 divide by n plus 1 plus a constant. And this is true for almost every value of n. But what is this not true for?
-1.
Yeah, it's true for almost any value of n except -1. And in the single case, in that single case, when n is -1, this is the antiderivative. Antiderivative of 1 over x dx. What is the antiderivative? Good. Log of what?
Absolute value of
x plus a constant. Good. And then there's really only one other antiderivative that we know in this class. Okay, it's this one, the antiderivative of e to x dx. Which is what?
Plus
c. So these are the only antiderivatives that we know in this class. Now there's a whole long list of other antiderivatives that are known in the wide world, but these are the only ones that we deal with in this class. Okay. So just to broaden our scope just a little bit and to foreshadow what's coming, let's get a new one. So how about the antiderivative of e to kx dx? So notice that this one doesn't appear in this list. It's not one of the ones in the list. So let's imagine for just a minute, I'm asking you to compute an antiderivative. Let's imagine that we were doing exactly the opposite for a minute. If we were computing a derivative, well, what is the derivative of e to kx? Okay, so not k minus 1, that's sounding like the power rule, right? So then the power rule, the derivative of x to the n is nx to n minus 1. So the power rule is when you're subtracting something.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. If you were computing the derivative of e to the kx, that's the derivative of an exponential. So you'd get that exponential back. You would get e to kx. But then for the chain rule, you'd need to multiply by the derivative of kx. And what is the derivative of kx with respect to x?
K.
It's k. So if we were differentiating, we would get e to kx multiplied by k. But we're anti-differentiating. So we're going to do the opposite of that. We're going to get e to kx and then what? Divide by k. Divide by k. Let's see why that's the case. Okay, so this is the claim. I claim this is true. How do we verify that this is in fact true? Because let's compute a derivative, right? Remember, last time we started with that remark, the definition that said the following are equivalent, right? So this is an anti-differentiation sentence. An anti-differentiation sentence. Let's make the corresponding differentiation sentence, which is to say, let's differentiate the right-hand side here. I won't even write the plus c because I know its derivative is zero. So we want to differentiate e to kx divide by k. Well, division by k is same as multiplication by 1 over k. So that 1 over k can be factored out of the derivative. So that'd be 1 over k derivative of e to kx. So I factored out the 1 over k. So now we want to compute the derivative of e to kx. Well, that's an exponential, so we will get it back. So just e to kx by itself.
So
and then,
use the chain rule?
So I'm about to. So for the chain rule, we need to multiply by the derivative of kx. Yes. And so what is the derivative of kx? It is k. So multiplied by k. And then now we can commute this multiply by k to the front, or we can commute the 1 over k to the back, whatever you like. And then in either case, the k over k cancels, and we get e to kx. Notice that what we have ended with, is exactly what we started with. Does it flip upside down?
Yeah.
What happens is that this it's not this wire actually, it's this thing has a tilt sensor in it. If I tilt it too far up like this, then it will stop flipping, but then I can't write up there. Yeah, it's a little. Does it really?
Mm-hmm.
That's annoying. Okay, so let's try it. Is it doing it now?
No.
Just when you write for someone.
Oh, wow, that's terrible. Is there some way I can fix it? Oh, you know what it was? Right here, there's a little that you can't see. Right there. There's a little sensor. It had some dust on it. Okay. Nope.
No.
Spoke too soon.
Okay. Cover the sensor.
Okay. Just tell me if it.
Can we cover the sensor?
Okay. I think it's all right.
Yeah.
Just remember that I can't.
Yeah, I was gonna ask. Can you see it in the recording when it flips over?
No, because it's this that's flipping over.
Oh, it's not the recording.
My GoPro camera
doesn't
do
oh,
that.
Oh, yeah, I guess that makes sense. Okay. That little thing you just did, is that all recorded now?
Yeah, it's going to be published on YouTube tonight.
Awesome. All right. No, we're doing
both. Just remember that I can't see the screen.
Yeah.
Okay. The piece of paper is staying still. Okay. I totally lost my spot. Oh, yeah, here we are. So, antiderivative of e to 5x dx is what? Yeah, very good. So e to 5x over 5. Plus a constant. So really nothing special about this one. This is just when k is 5. Okay, how about antiderivative of e to 4x to 3 dx. Yes. Right. So then, for this one, you need to perform an algebraic simplification first. So this iterated exponentiation, e to 4x to 3, the exponent, the iterated exponents can be combined into what? E to 12x. And then, okay, I get the joke, right? It's the same as before, except k is 12. So e to 12x over 12 plus a constant. Any question about this one? Okay. Good. So any question before we, so this is just sort of a review of what we did last time. Any question before we move to new things? Okay. So we're talking about antiderivatives, and antidifferentiation is the reverse procedure of differentiation. And you, in Calculus 1, learned all those derivative rules. And at the present time, we're learning all of the corresponding antiderivative anti-rules. Okay, so for every rule that you knew for differentiation, there's a corresponding anti-rule. So for differentiation, you learned the chain rule. Okay, and today we're going to do the anti-chain rule. Except for historical reasons, it's not called the anti-chain rule. It's called substitution. So this is section 7.2. Substitution. And so to bring the topic across, first we're just going to do chain rule for a little bit. Okay, we're going to do chain rule for a few minutes to really remember that and get that going, and then we're going to start doing it in reverse. Okay. So this section is essentially the anti-chain rule. Okay, so what if f of x is, how about 3x to 5 plus e to 4x to the 10, and I want you to find the derivative of this. Okay. So in order to do this, we'll need the chain rule. So derivative of all this crazy business and the way the chain rule works is it differentiates a composed expression like this, sort of like by peeling an onion. You do the outermost bit first. So specifically, the outermost function here is the function that takes its argument and raises it to 10. So the pattern that is at play here is this is the derivative with respect to x of u to 10. So that's the pattern that's at play here. And the power rule is what will occur. So what is the derivative of, if this was x to 10, what would the derivative be?
10 u to the 9.
Right. So 10 and then u to 9. Right. So if u was x, then we would stop here, if u was x. But it's not. It's a function of x. So in order to make this right, the chain rule says that now it, you need to multiply by du dx. Okay? So is everybody okay with this being the pattern? Mm-hmm. Okay. So one step in the procedure is to say, okay, this is 10. 3x to 5 plus e to 4x to 9, and then multiply by the derivative of 3 times x to 5 plus e to 4x. Okay, this green is du dx. And this red is 10u to 9. Good. So have we answered the exercise?
No,
right? Because we still have this derivative remaining, right? So now the derivative needs to distribute in. So this is this, but this first part is finished. So it needs only be copied. So 3x to 5 plus e to 4x to 9, and then the derivative distributes in. What is the derivative of 3 times x to 5?
15x to the
4. Very good. 15x to 4. And then what is the derivative of e to 4x? Not divide by 4, multiply by 4. So e to 4x multiply by 4.
So we did the chain rule inside of the chain?
Yes. So you can take the phrases chain rule, product rule, quotient rule, and you can put them in any order that you wish. And I can make an exercise where you're required to do that, right? An exercise where you must do the chain rule, followed by the product rule, followed by 47 chain rules, followed by the quotient rule.
In this situation, the reason we can do the derivative of each individual piece is because the derivative can be broken up into with the plus sign. Right.
Right. That's the sum rule.
The sum rule.
Yeah. Other questions? Another question that frequently comes up is, whenever I compute the derivative of an exponential, I write the 4 or whatever it is over here. I write e to the 4x times 4. Inevitably, some student asks, well, can I write 4 times e to the 4x? Well, can you?
Yes.
Yes? Mm-hmm. Why can you?
Because multiplication.
Yeah, because multiplication is commutative. E to 4x multiplied by 4, like this, is the same as 4 multiplied by e to 4x. They're the same. But I'll always write it on the right-hand side for two reasons. First off, that's the way the chain rule works. That's how it looks. So I make it look the same. Second is that when you go on to more advanced science and math courses, you eventually start dealing with mathematical objects where multiplication does not commute. Okay, and then in that case, this order is the right order. There's plenty of things that don't commute in real life. Okay, an example is something like the order in which you do a procedure, right? So an example would be when you're getting dressed, does it matter if you put on your left sock first or your right sock first? It doesn't matter, right? The result is the same, which is to say that if someone put on their left, you would not be able to detect when someone has both their socks on which sock they put on first. How about pants and underwear?
There's definitely
some. Oh, yeah, yeah. You can detect, right? The there's a difference, right? So left sock and right sock commutes, but pants and underwear don't. Okay, so this commutes, but eventually in further math courses, it doesn't. Good. Any questions about this one? Okay, let's have another. Okay, how about
that's simplify it at that point? We'll do four.
But he's saying it's either way. You can do.
Oh, you because you actually left the thing there. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, please don't simplify. Yeah. So the standing order is that please don't simplify unless you are specifically requested to simplify. Okay. Sorry?
You don't want us to do 9 times 3 inches.
No, please don't, right? Simplification is not very interesting in a calculus course, to be honest with you. Right?
Yeah.
Just to be honest. Okay, so Homo sapiens, we organized ourselves into societies, okay, as far as I'm concerned, to make it to where we could make machines that would simplify for us, right? Let's not simplify, right? Humans are not very good at it anyway, right? We're much better at making machines that do it, right? Like, we can farm, but we have nothing on a combine, right? Combine can really farm. Okay. Okay, so I lost my spot again. Y'all are confusing me. Okay, so then how about the square root of x squared plus the log of x cubed plus 5x. Okay, and I want you to compute the derivative of h. Okay. So derivative of this square root thing. So what is the pattern? So just like I wrote a pattern up here, just like I wrote a pattern up here, what is the pattern that's currently in play here? Sorry? Right. So yes, you can reckon square root as half, but what I'm trying to get you to see is that you need to use the chain rule, and what's at play here is that you're differentiating a function that looks like this, the square root of u. That's what you're differentiating. The outermost function is the square root function. And then everything inside we're calling u. Well, what is the derivative? Well, if this was x, what is the derivative of the square root of x? Right. So it's probably worth your time to memorize that the derivative of the square root of x is 1 over 2 square root x. Okay, that you can rewrite the square root as fractional exponent half, and then you can get to here. But it's probably worth your time to just memorize this because it occurs quite frequently. So is that the answer? Is that the whole thing? No, right? Because for the chain rule, we also need du dx. So does everybody see that this is the pattern that's at play currently? Okay, good. So this would be 1 divided by 2, and then that square root craziness. And then now, for the chain rule, we need to multiply by the derivative of x squared plus, not the derivative of 2x, the derivative of x squared plus log of x cubed plus 5x. Okay, so not 2x, because at least the way I'm writing it, I haven't differentiated it yet. Okay, so now we need to do this. Well, what's the derivative? This one is easy, right? What's the derivative of x squared? 2x. This one? This one's a little more entertaining. What will we need for this one? Yeah, we'll need the chain rule, right? Good. Okay, so this will be 1 over... This first part is finished, so it needs only be copied. So square root x squared plus log x cubed plus 5x. So when your previous calculus instructor was talking about derivatives of logs, did they say u prime over u?
Yes.
This thing? Is that common?
Yes.
Okay. So yes, when you compute the derivative of log, if you call this v, since we already used u, then the derivative of log of v would be v prime over v. So this would be 2x, because that's the derivative of x squared, and then plus, to switch notation a little bit, x cubed plus 5x prime over x cubed plus 5x. So is this okay? V prime over V? Yeah, I'll do it. But I wrote the prime, right? So that's my signal to myself that there's yet stuff to do.
So the derivative of a log is prime over
number. Right. So which is to say that for this now, the way that we're reckoning it is that the derivative with respect to x of the log of v is v prime over v, right? Or if you like, 1 over v times dv dx, so that it looks like that one. In either way. So to finish, one over two x squared plus log x cubed plus 5x multiplied by 2x plus 3x squared plus 5 over x cubed plus 5x. Any questions about this one?
Back to the log.
This?
If that was x, because I don't understand the difference between du over dx and the way that you're writing it up there.
V prime?
Yeah, because if you were to differentiate that, it would be dv over dx, right?
V prime is shorthand notation for dv dx. They're synonyms. They mean the same thing.
Right. But if it was an x in there instead of v, it would just...
X prime is 1. Because if v was x, that would be dx dx. Which is 1. I don't know if I've answered your question. I haven't. Okay.
That's okay. I'll like
it. Okay.
Okay, I have a question.
Okay.
So could you, instead of doing what you did, the x squared plus log of x cubed plus 5x, now that first one, could you just make that whole notation to the power of 1/2?
Yes.
Is that acceptable? Would that be acceptable?
Yeah.
Okay, because yeah. That's my preference. I like getting rid of this.
Okay. Yeah, it's fine.
Is that okay? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, I felt like that's what...
That's
how we learned it. So we would have changed that equation to the 1/2 power, and then it would have...
It would have been to negative 1/2.
Yes, it would be 1/2, you know, the equation to the negative 1/2 times...
It's the same thing.
And that'd be fine.
Is that fine? Okay, I just wanted to make sure that if I did it that way, because that's the way I was taught.
No, it's definitely fine.
Okay. I hate to be called.
Yes?
Can we use f of x prime instead of d over dx?
Yeah, you can use the prime notation. That's fine. As long as you use it correctly.
Really?
I personally prefer this notation. And the reason why is because soon, sorry, L'Hopital, that's a different matter. But very soon, we will have functions of multiple variables. And then you can't use the prime notation. Okay. So any questions about the chain rule? So So any questions about, if you have a question, please ask, and I'll address it. Okay. So any questions about the chain rule before we start moving to the anti-chain rule? Okay, so now, on the off chance that your instructor, your previous instructor, didn't explain to you what the chain rule is doing, right? Let's see what the chain rule is actually doing so that it's not just some magical incantation that you've memorized. Right? So it's actually doing something. The chain rule is actually one of the fundamental ideas in all of mathematics and science. Okay? So in sort of a boring fashion, you can just write down the chain rule. The derivative of the composition of functions, the derivative of f of g of x, is the derivative of f evaluated at g of x, and then multiplied by the derivative of g evaluated at x. So that's just, many students get to this position in calculus 2 and they just have this memorized, but they're not really sure what it means. So what this means is the following. So suppose we have an axis, and these are x's, and we have another axis, and these are u's, and we have another axis, and these are y's. And suppose that we have a rule that tells us how to turn x's into u's. So we've got a function. U is g of x. And suppose we have another rule, another function, that tells us how to turn a u into a y. So we've got another function. Y is f of u. So what these functions do is they're two steps in a machine. So here's one step and another step. So taking these rules together, it's a rule on how to turn an x into a y, right? First you turn it into a u with g, and then you turn it into a y with f. So you could do these all together. You could do these all together and say that y is f of g of x. So that's just composition, right? How you turn an x into a y. Okay, so now imagine that we're interested in this x in particular. Okay, so this x in particular. So let's say that this x in particular is turned into this u in particular. So this x becomes this u. And then this u becomes this y. So that means that this x, if we covered up the internals of the machine, then and we just watched the machine from the outside, we would watch this x become this y directly. Okay, that's what we would observe from the outside. So this is what composition is. This is what composition is, and you learned that in college algebra. So what the chain rule is saying is it's saying, well, what about the derivative, right? This is telling you how G does its work, and this is telling you how F does its work. What about the derivative? So the derivative comes in when you say, okay, I'm going to take a little piece of the x's now. Instead of just one x, I'm going to take a little piece of x, a little oriented arrow. Okay, so this arrow is pointed up, and it has, and you can measure its length, how long it is. So let's say that you take this arrow and you use g and you map the whole arrow with g, and let's say that you observe this. So the arrow is going to move up a little bit, and I'm going to say that it's going to get a little bit taller. So it was magnified. So you can see, it got a little bit bigger. Got a little bit bigger. And then let's take the green arrow, the U arrow, and let's map it into Y's. And so what will happen is that this green arrow will move down a little bit, and I'll say that it gets even bigger, just to make the picture easier to draw. So now, not only do we have position of the arrow being tracked, we also have sizes of arrows being tracked. And if you were to just cover up the internals of the machine, then you would observe the red arrow become the blue arrow directly, and you'd see this. Something that looks like that. That's not a very good line, is it? Okay, so now, G is telling you how the red arrow moves up and down to become the green arrow. What is telling you how the red arrow has to get bigger to become the green arrow? G tells you how it moves. What tells you how it gets bigger? The derivative of G tells you how it gets bigger. The derivative of G tells you how it gets bigger. Specifically, we can call this one dx. And if we call the red arrow on the x-axis dx, then what are we going to call the arrow on the u-axis?
Du.
This one is du. And so the thing that relates all of these is that du is the derivative of g evaluated at x multiplied by dx, which is to say that the green arrow is the red arrow multiplied by this scale. So if the derivative was 2, then the green arrow would be twice as big as the red arrow. That's what it would mean. Okay, so then if we call this one dx and this one du, then what's this one? dy. And what tells you how the sizes of du and dy are related?
Dy equals f prime.
Yes. Dy is f prime evaluated at u du. And so now here's the question. Here's the question. Is that what if you cover up the machine? What if you cover up the machine, the internals of the machine, and you just observe how the red arrow becomes the blue arrow? How does its size change? Well, first it's changed by this factor, and then it's changed by this factor. So if this derivative was 2, then it'd be 2, and if this derivative was 3, it'd be 2 times 3, right? So it would be 6 altogether. So how does this change? It changes like this. Dy is f prime evaluated at u. So f prime evaluated at u times du, but du is this. So it would be g prime evaluated at x dx. Now, I'm going to take this red equation and write it right here. So dy is f prime evaluated at u, g prime evaluated at x dx. But don't we have a way to write u in terms of x? It's g of x, isn't it? So this is saying that dy is f prime evaluated at g of x multiplied by g prime evaluated at x dx. And don't you recognize this? What is this? This is the chain rule. That's the chain rule. So what the chain rule is saying, it's telling you that when you have a machine that's composed of multiple stages where things happen in order, it's telling you how the individual operations interact with each other to move the object around and change its size. So an example, the go-to example for this is something like a compound microscope. So a compound microscope is the thing that you use in biology class, and you look into it, and then you turn the three thingies around, you know, and you select the magnification. So this the turny thing, that's called the objective lens. So imagine that the objective lens is currently set to 40x, and the eyepiece is a 10x eyepiece. What is the total magnification? 400. Because what happens is the photons pass through the specimen, and then they pass through the objective lens and are spread out by a factor of 40. And then they continue up the body of the microscope and pass through the eyepiece and are spread out by another factor of 10. So the total magnification is 400. So when a mathematician uses a microscope, they're thinking, chain rule, right? It's a chain rule. Everywhere, it's a chain rule, okay? So another example is you probably made it to campus in a vehicle run by an internal combustion engine, very likely. So at cruising speed, the RPMs in your motor are on the order of 2,000 RPMs. So are your wheels traveling? Are your wheels rotating that fast?
No.
No, they're not. Okay, so then the speed of the motor has to be, I don't know, I'm not an expert. I think it has to be reduced, right? So if your engine is undergoing 2,000 RPMs, then that has to go through a gearbox to be changed to the right RPMs for your wheel. So if you have a reduction gear that reduces RPMs by half, followed by another reduction gear that reduces RPMs by a third, what's the total reduction? A sixth. Right? And so every time a mathematician is driving a internal combustion engine and changing the changes gears, chain rule, right? Chain rule is happening. Okay? Good. So any question about the chain rule and what it means? So it's not too much to say that it really is one of the fundamental ideas of science. It's how you compose parts and how they interact with each other. Okay. So now what we want to do is we want to do the chain rule in reverse. So probably best to start with an example. So antiderivative of 2x cubed plus 5 and then multiplied by 6x squared dx. So if I gave you this exercise right now and you only had the knowledge that we've talked about in this class, right? No other illicit knowledge that you may have gained in other classes, right? Then what would you need to do? Yeah, multiply it out, collect like terms. That's what you would do. Okay, so now I'm gonna make that untenable for you. Okay, so now what would you do? Cry and go home, right? So with that 13, it's no longer reasonable to multiply this out and collect like terms. Okay. So what we're going to do to solve this exercise, we're looking for, you know, sometimes you go out into a park and then you see a tree and someone has written a message in the tree. You know what I'm talking about? So we're looking for a message that looks like this. Chain rule was here, right? So that's what we're looking for. So do you see anything that sort of looks like the chain rule was involved?
Yes. 6x squared is the derivative.
Ah, yeah. So do you observe, this 6x squared is the derivative of that, isn't it? It's the derivative of 2x cubed. In fact, we can do better than that. We can do better than saying that 6x squared is the derivative of just that term. Because it's derivative of all of this, right? Because the derivative of 5 is 0, because it's a constant. So if we were to say that u, this variable, is 2x cubed plus 5, what we want to do is we want to change the variables from x's to u's. So this is going to be, is called a change of variables. And if this was an algebra problem, then we'd be in good shape. But this is a calculus problem. It's a calculus problem involving not only variables, which are the x's, but these other things. And this dx is not a variable. It's a different kind of object. So now we need to give this object a name. We formerly did not have a name for it. So does anyone know the name of these objects? They're called differentials. So this is called a differential. So we're going to change variables. And in a calculus problem, every time you change variables, you must also change differentials. We can't just change the x's into u's and leave the dx's. It's not okay for u's and dx's to be hanging around, right? That's not okay. So we need to change x's into u's, and we also need to change dx's into du's. So specifically what we'll do is we need to compute. So du dx. So what is du dx? Six x squared. And then now we can solve for du to obtain that this is du is 6x squared dx. So I'd like for you to observe now that this whole red thing, this red part of the antiderivative we're working on, is going to be replaced with what?
Du.
With du. This piece gets substituted with that piece. And this piece gets substituted with what?
U.
Just u. So does everyone see how what's being substituted for what? So now that that has a that we have that determined, this is the antiderivative of u du. And so, yes, did I make an error?
Yes.
I did? Where?
To the power function.
Oh, right. Good. It's a good thing that I left enough horizontal space for that. Okay, so that red 13 is, I don't know. I mean, so I'll just say this. I've graded a lot of exercises. And for some reason, on a certain percentage of exercises, that just seems to be left off. Okay? So I'd like for you to observe that the variable and the differential are in agreement. The variables are in u, the differential is du. Right? So by agreement, I mean we have variables in u and not dx's or something. Okay? So now, is this one of the antiderivatives that you know?
Yes.
Ah, it is, isn't it? Right? So then what is the antiderivative of u to 13? Good. U to 14 divided by 14 plus a constant. And then, is this the answer to the question?
No.
No. Why is this why is this not the answer to the question?
Because you have to substitute that back in.
Right. The question was phrased in terms of symbol x. So your answer must be phrased in terms of symbol x. It's currently phrased in terms of what?
U.
U. Okay. So then the answer is 2x cubed plus 5 to 14 divide by 14 plus constant. So this right here, this is called the change of variables, and this is called the change of differentials. Okay, good. Any question about this? It was replaced entirely by du. So 6x squared dx got replaced by du. Other questions?
Then what happened to du?
When we did this? Yeah, this is antiderivative because the definition, right? So then this one, we have a rule that says the antiderivative of u to n du is u to n plus 1 divided by n plus 1 plus a constant. And this means, so at the beginning of last lecture, we wrote down the meaning of this sentence. It was a remark that had TFAE in it. The following are equivalent. This means is equivalent to the statement, the derivative of u to n plus 1 divided by n plus 1 is u to n. Other questions? What in?
I don't know what in.
In the blue?
Yeah. So we were just saying that's just a rule.
Yeah, this is a rule that we went over last time. Yeah. And I just to remind you, the meaning of this sentence is equivalent to this one. Their meanings are the same. Specifically, this sentence was defined to mean this.
So the derivative of u n plus 1 over n plus 1 is equal to u.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? Okay, so let's do another one, since this was so great. Okay, so it can be, you can play around with this just a little bit. So how about, yeah, why not? So for example, antiderivative of, say, x, and then 5x squared plus 4 to the silly exponent dx. Okay, so what do you think? Do what? Multiply out and collect like terms?
You're going to have a 10 left over. It's
10x squared, you only have an x.
Okay, so you're saying, I think you're telling me take u to be the thing inside.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, so this is the first heuristic. So what does the word heuristic mean? Sorry? So heuristic means good idea. Okay, it doesn't mean rule. Right? It doesn't mean that you will do this every time. It means that it is a good idea to try the following. Okay? So the first heuristic in the first heuristic that we have for anti-differentiating is try to substitute u is something inside. So something inside. So I put inside in quotes because that's a little ambiguous. So by inside I mean, notice that here you have something inside of exponent to 37. So let's try to make u this and just see what happens. So u is 5x squared plus 4. If we do that, then we'll need du. So I'm going to say du is what? So 10x. So is this right?
No. X is dx.
Dx, right? Yes. So here's a sentence. And under no circumstance can this sentence ever be correct. And the reason why it can never be correct is because this object right here, du, is an object of category differential. So it's its own kind of thing. We don't talk about it a lot in our class, but it's a thing. Like a cat is a thing, right? And a cat is not a dog, right? So this object is an object of category differential, whereas this thing is of category scalar or function, right? So what you're saying, this equation can never be true because the left-hand side is not the same category as the right-hand side.
Okay.
Differential equal to scalar function. Yeah, cat cannot be dog, right? So to make this right, you have to put dx. So now this is right. A scalar function multiplied by a differential is a differential. So now, left-hand side category is differential, right-hand side category is differential. I bring
why
this...
Why would we do that?
Why?
In the first place?
Do what?
Yeah, why would we find the derivative of that?
Because we're trying to perform a variable substitution, and every variable substitution must be accompanied by a differential substitution.
Wouldn't you just do that on the x?
Yeah, so we're going to do that, but right now I'm trying to think about what your question means.
Well, in the last problem, we had the change of variables, so we had u is equal to 2x cubed plus y.
Yes.
And then we moved on to changing the differential, which we ended up with du over dx is equal to 6x squared, and 6x squared was outside of the parentheses.
Okay.
In the last problem.
Okay.
So in this case, in the same instance, you would, it seems like the change of variable, you would just change the 5x squared plus 4 to u, and then the x would be what we would find, we would use to change the differential.
Ah, okay, now I get it. No, okay, now I understand. Okay. So when you're doing an exercise like this, this is the one that you can choose. Once you've chosen this one, you don't have a choice for this one. This one is a consequence of that one. Once you choose this one is automatically chosen.
Oh, so we just take that first chunk that we take, that we're going to change the variable for, and then we find the derivative of
it. Yes, that's why. What is the derivative of 5x squared plus 4?
I was thinking we were using the 6x that was on the outside
right.
of the parentheses.
Yeah. You only get to choose u. Du is a consequence. Okay. Yes? No. That's why I wrote heuristic. So heuristic means good idea, but not always. So we're going to do lots and lots of examples. We're going to do examples until you're bored of it, is my goal. Okay, so then now. Okay.
I'm sorry, where did the 10 come from?
What is the derivative of 5x squared plus 4? It's 10x.
And then, so wouldn't the derivative be du over dx is equal to 10x?
Yes. And then you solve for du.
And then you bring the dx over.
Very good. So now. If you're ever a teacher, I know that some of you had it in the first place. That's fine. I'm happy. But if you're ever a teacher, you should know that you need to address questions immediately when they occur. Because if someone has a question and you don't answer their question right then and there, then you might as well stop talking to that person. Because they can't hear the rest of it because they're stuck. Okay? Okay, so we're going to replace, we want to attempt to replace this with what?
You.
With you. Okay, now, we want to make all of this you. So then, now, if we do this, do we have something for dx? Oh, we have this dx, that's good. What about for this x?
No, we have it
at 10. That'll work. But what about that 10?
Yeah.
Very good. So, if we divide by 10, this is now x dx. And do you observe that we could commute this x to be with its buddy dx? It could be over here. So this green part, x dx, is all going to be replaced with what?
Du.
Du over 10. Okay, so this is antiderivative of u to 37, and then du over 10. So any questions about getting to this position? Yes?
You divided it by 10 because you wanted it to be.
Because I didn't have a 10 up here. Right. I had an x and I had a dx. But I didn't have a 10. So it might help you if I rewrite this just a little bit, if I say that this is 5x squared plus 4 to 37. And then x dx, right? So what do we have? We have x dx. We don't have 10x dx, so I divided by 10. Okay, so then now, this division by 10 is the same as multiplication by a tenth. So that tenth can come out. And then you look at this and say, oh, I get the joke, right? It's the power rule again, right? So, so this would be u to 38 divided by 38 plus a constant. Is this the answer?
No.
So then we need to resubstitute. So this would be 5x squared plus 4 to 38 divided by 38 plus a constant.
And we don't need to simplify.
Please don't simplify.
Awesome.
Any question about this one? Okay.
How did you get 1 divided by 10?
How did I get 1 divided by 10? Because are you okay at this one?
Yeah.
So this is du multiplied by 1 over 10. Right, division by 10 is multiplication by 1 over 10. So I factored the 1 out of over 10 out of the antiderivative. Yes?
Can we write 1 10 du equals x to the x to the and just keep the 1 10 out from the division by 10?
Yeah, yeah. Yes? Other questions? Yes? Please leave it like this.
So is your goal to get the U37 du?
Yes. Your goal is to get here.
That's exactly how it would solve.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So specifically, so stage magicians. You know that those people that do that. So it's considered taboo among them to reveal the way a trick works, right? So they really frown upon their colleagues when they're showing the way that it works. So now I'm going to do the taboo thing. I'm going to show you exactly the way every single one of these questions works. So all of them work exactly in the following way. So in this class, we know exactly 3 antiderivatives. We know exactly three. We know the antiderivative of u to n du is what? Very good. So this is the power rule. And this works for almost every value of n, but not every value.
-1.
It works for all of them except -1. In that single case, the antiderivative is 1 over u du. And we know this one also. What is this one? Right, log absolute u plus c. And then the only other one that we know is e to u du. And what is this one? E to u plus c. Now, in the wide universe, or let's just say in the realm of current human knowledge, there's a lot more antiderivatives than these three. But these are the only three that we deal with in this class. Okay, these are all of them. We'll do a handful more as the semester goes, but it's going to top out like it's 6 or something like that. So we don't know many. So this is the way every single question goes. So let's make a question. Step 1, choose one of the 3. choose Choose one of these. So what do you want to choose? We're going to choose the first one? Okay. So we're going to choose, I'm going to choose U to 17. Okay. Step one is complete. Step two. Choose U as a function of X. A function that you know how to differentiate. Okay, so let's choose something that's mildly entertaining. How about U is E to X squared plus 1. That looks mildly entertaining. Okay, so now let's differentiate it. Let's differentiate it. So du, what is the derivative of e to x squared plus 1?
E to x squared plus 1 times 2x left.
Very good. E to x squared plus 1 multiplied by 2x and then dx. Okay? So now, substitute it in. Which is to say, I'm going to take this.
So did we skip a step there?
No. What step?
If we were just to differentiate, it would just be du over dx is equal to.
Right. The intermediate step that I'm not writing, because I want you to get accustomed to not writing it, is du dx is e to x squared plus 1 multiplied by 2x. Yeah. Okay, so then now we're going to perform a substitution. We're going to replace this u with that, and we're going to replace du with that. Okay, so so it'll be e to x squared plus 1 to 17, and then so that's u to 17. And then du, well, that's e to x squared plus 1 times 2x dx. And so now I'm going to just algebraically play with it a little bit to make it just slightly more complicated. Okay, so now let's do an exercise. Please perform the following antiderivative. Well, what do you think? Oh, you think we should do u as e to x squared plus 1? Okay. Let's see what happens. So we'll try. So we're using the heuristic, right? Do you see that you've got these big parentheses and then something to 17? Okay, let's try and say u is everything in there. Okay. E to x squared plus 1. Okay, and then what's the derivative? So okay, e to x squared plus 1
times
2x and then dx. Okay, do we have all of those things?
Yes.
Oh, we do. Oh, incredible. Does this seem a little bit forced?
Yes.
Okay, good. Because it is. Right? But I'm telling you that this is what your math instructors are doing back in their office. Okay? Like, I'm going to go tonight. Okay, I'm going to go do this. I'm going to say, I'm going to choose one of the three antiderivatives that we know, you know, and then I'm going to do exactly this. So this is going to be replaced with u. And then, oh, look, the rest of this can be replaced with du. Amazing that it's going to work like that. And if we do that, substitution, then what does it become?
U to 17 du.
U to 17 du. Is that one of the antiderivatives that we know? Mm-hmm. Oh, it is. It is one of the antiderivatives that we know. So the answer is u to 18 over 18 plus a constant. And so then the answer is e to x squared plus 1 to 18 divide by 18 plus a constant. All of the substitution exercises that exist are made in this way. So what that means is that when I give you an exercise, okay, when I give you an exercise that requires substitution, it cannot branch from this pattern. There is no way to deviate from it. Okay, so that being said, so here's an example. So I'm going to put some round parentheses right here. And I'm going to do square root. And I'm going to put x squared here. And then an even number multiplied by x. And then plus a random number. So how about 19 dx. And then now that I've done that inside of these round parentheses, I'm going to write x plus 6. So I'm telling you literally what I just did is I literally just did that procedure that I wrote on two pages ago, but I did it in my head. Okay? So what do you think? Right. So here's another heuristic, which is really just the same heuristic as before. Remember, heuristic just means good idea. It doesn't mean it's a rule. The heuristic is try to substitute u is the argument to a radical. Okay, so we'll try and make u is the stuff in the radical.
What is the ARD stand for?
Our argument. When you have a function f of x, the x is called the argument. So with respect to this radical, the argument is that quadratic, is the x squared plus 12x plus 19. So we'll try that. U is that thing. Okay, then what's du? Okay, so du is 2x plus 12 dx. And then we look back and say, oh, we don't have a 12x or whatever. Ah, okay, so do you see that if you divide both sides by 2, right, 2 is common to this, so it can be factored out and then divided. So this is du over 2 is x plus 6 dx. And then do you see, we have everything covered then if we do this. Okay, so is everybody okay with this position? So specifically, this is being substituted with u, and this is being substituted with du over 2.
Did you divide this whole to the right side by 2?
Divided both sides by 2, yeah. So, so, doing this, so any question about getting to this position? This one right here. So, sorry?
I always keep it on the square root 2. I always keep it to U.
Okay, well, whatever you like. So this would be, I'm going to factor out the half, and then I agree with the crowd that we should write this as half, because it kind of helps you do the power rule. And then you look at this and say, oh, okay, I see what the question maker had in mind. They had U to half in mind. So the power rule is, so that half stays, and then it'll be U to half plus 1. What's half plus 1?
3/2.
So it'll be U to 3/2 over 3/2, and then plus a constant, and then substituting in. X squared plus 12x plus 19 to 3/2 over 3/2.
So we don't even have to simplify.
Plus a comma. Please don't. So that comment, please don't comment, has a couple meanings. So first off, please don't. Okay, but that's really only in the case of antiderivatives. So in the coming lectures, we're going to do a related procedure called integration. And when integration, when we're integrating, it will be necessary for you to simplify. So it's not like a blanket don't simplify. It's when we're doing antiderivatives, just please don't simplify. Okay, but when you're integrating, you have to. Other questions?
Would the alternate, if you hadn't taken away the radical, just have been 1/2 and then it all be u plus c?
No. This you have to reckon this as a power rule.
Okay.
Yeah. This is the antiderivative. Yeah. Other questions? No, I can't. But I'll go slow. I'll go slow. Okay. So, we'll talk real slow. Okay. Yeah. We should talk about history or something.
No, freak him out. Whatever.
You'll have another sheet, and when he comes in, like, pull it away.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
It's like have one.
Whatever the
fourth
chapter
is
ahead of this.
No.
And say some word that he doesn't know.
I'm pretty sure every word he was saying.
We have to be kind to one another.
No, that's the fun part of it.
I know.
You better never miss a class. Oh,
seriously. Okay, so how about this one?
This is a du over u, so you have to figure out what your du will be. Right? It's du over u.
No, I think you do.
This is the ln absolute value of x.
Yeah, 1 over x. Is that what you mean? The rule that 1 over x rule.
Right?
Well, let's write down what we know. We just know 3 of them, right?
Right.
Here you go.
And there's no quotient.
So we know u to n du We know that one. We know 1 over u du. And we know e to u du. Those are the three that we know. So let's at least eliminate one possibility.
It's not u to n.
It's not the first one, I think. Okay. So I think the fraction is leading y'all to say, well, maybe it's the middle one.
Yeah.
So it's e to u.
Because we all think it's the other one.
But consider this one for a minute.
Yeah. Dang it.
Think about it for a minute. Notice there's exponential in here.
Oh, it's raised to root. Yeah, you can't. Yeah, ln is what it's going from.
Right. So what do you think?
It's e to u.
U is 1 over x. Okay, well, if we were going to do this sort of directly, then if we want to do that, you're saying that this is e to u, and apparently everything else must be du?
No.
Well, how do we confirm or deny that?
Because the derivative of 1 over x isn't 1 over x squared.
Is it not?
Oh, gosh. No. Because it's log of absolute value of x.
No, the antiderivative of 1 over x is log of absolute value of x. Antiderivative, not the derivative. Right? So let's...
Oh, yes, it is. It's 1 over x.
Okay, good. So let's...
x to the negative 1.
The quickest way to confirm or deny is just to write it down. Just write it down and try. So if u is 1 over x, so these are just... we just wrote these down just so we could look at them. It's not part of the problem. So if u is 1 over x...
you bring the x to the top and have the negative x.
Yes. So 1 over x is good for algebra, but for calculus, what's better for calculus?
X to the negative 1.
X to negative 1. So what is du then?
X to the negative 2.
Negative x to the negative 2. Dx. And if you were to write this now with positive exponents, where'd the negative come from?
Because I know where the negative came from, but then it's negative 1 over x squared, right?
What did we do with that 10?
Oh, we just put it, so you just multiply that.
Yes. So you could rewrite this as du is negative 1 over x squared dx. And now this is starting to look better, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, so if I rewrite the original antiderivative in this way, so the antiderivative of e to 1 over x multiplied by 1 over x squared dx, then it's starting to look pretty good.
Yes. Except we need to handle the negative.
Yeah, except now we need to handle the negative. So I'll say that this is du divided by negative 1 is 1 over x squared. Well, okay.
Can we not just say that?
You could write negative du, but then you have to have parentheses so that you're not subtracting du when you substitute it in. Right? Okay. So this... right here, 1 over x is being replaced with u.
So if we multiply it by negative 1, would that be different?
So you're asking...
I have issues with dividing a fraction.
I think what you're asking is, can I write this? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, there's nothing wrong with doing that. But I'm about to show you why I did this instead of that.
Couldn't you just factor out the negative 1 once you get on
it? Yeah, I suppose you could do it that way if you thought of it that way. Yeah, that'd be fine. But the reason why I don't do that in class is because that's doing more than one step at a time. And so I have a strict policy of for myself to only do one step at a time when I'm teaching. So this with u, and this with du over negative 1, or negative du, whatever is better for your point of view. This would be e to u, and then du divided by negative 1. So I think what I was avoiding writing this, which looks weird. Right, that looks like e to u minus du. But I think what you wanted to say is, well, the first thing that you would write is this. And that's fine. That's fine. But I'm not going to write this because it looks weird. Right? So to make it right, you'd have to do it like that. And then it looks even more weird.
Yeah.
So I do it like that. Okay, whatever. So then... Yes. One way or another, we get to here, right? Okay, and then this is negative e to u plus a constant. And so this is what? Negative e to 1 over x plus a constant. So the way this exercise was made, you could think, is that instructor selected this one, said, okay, well, I need to choose one of these three. I choose that one. And then now I need to choose something for you. I choose 1 over x. And then instructor got rid of the negative and then said, here's an exercise. Okay, good. Any question about this one? Okay. So, let's have a tricky one. No, it's not a joke.
Are we gonna get a joke today?
I'm gonna have to think about it. It's hard. So how about x times the square root of x plus 5 dx? So this one's tricky. This one's tricky. So here's the thing about these questions is that you're doing the chain rule in reverse, and because there's so many steps, okay, you need to know how you're constructed, right, the way you're made. And that is that an enormous portion of your intellect and computational power is in your visual cortex. Now, you, like all humans, probably fancy yourself as having a very good imagination, but in fact you don't, okay? You really don't, and it's nothing specific to you, it's just a cognitive bias that all humans have. Okay? So the best way to get going on a problem like this is to write something down. If you're sitting there staring into space and just imagining what you would do, that is a profoundly poor strategy. Okay? Because I'm telling you that your imagination is simply not as good as you think it is. And that's just a cognitive bias that everyone has. So the best way to get going is to take an idea out of your head, through your arm, through the pencil, onto the paper, so that you can look at the paper with your eyes and engage your visual cortex. Okay, that's how you get the idea out of your imagination and into your actual processing. Okay, So don't sit there and do nothing. Now, you have a heuristic rule that goes with this. What's the heuristic?
Find out which rule you're going
to
use.
Everything in the radical. Right? So which rule you're going to use is how you make a problem. We're trying to unmake a problem. Okay, so we have a heuristic that says, okay, try everything in the radical. Okay. So
du equals dx?
Okay. So if we do that, then du is dx. So if I assess the situation correctly, currently we would have something to substitute for this, right? This would become what?
U.
And then we have something for this. What does this become?
Du.
And so what you're telling me, I think, is that, we don't have anything for that x.
Yes, that's what I'm telling you.
We don't have anything for this x. Man, if only there was some kind of equation that we could solve for x.
Well, we could just use the first one, which is u is equal to x plus 5, and just substitute u minus 5 in for x.
Oh, you mean we could use this equation and solve for x?
Yes.
What? X plus 5 equals 0?
No, look.
Because all we needed to do is be in u.
Here's an equation. Can you solve for x?
Oh, because it just has to be in u form.
So u minus 5 is x. Now, I contend that you would not have been able to imagine that. But now that it's written on the page, it's pretty obvious. Now that you can see it with your own eyes. Okay, no, it's not obvious. Okay, so then... So then this is u minus 5, and then square root u, du. And you get here, and you might object and say, this doesn't look any better than where we started. But it actually is better. So why is it better? Sorry? Well, okay, so these things agree. Yeah, they were still in agreement, so that's still good. So it's good to be in that position. But why is this a better position than where we started?
Can we factor out that left-hand chart?
I'm not sure what you mean by factor out.
U minus 5 outside of the interval?
No, you can, no. You can think of these as boundaries. And anything that has a U in it cannot be factored out. It cannot be factored out. So the very first one that we did, right here. That's the very first one that we did. And before I wrote the 13, I said, if I gave you this exercise right now, what would you do?
Algebra?
Yeah. Algebra. Can you algebraically simplify this?
No.
Yes, you can. This is u times the square root of u plus, no, sorry, minus.
Minus 5 to the square root of u.
Minus 5 square root of u.
Yeah.
And so can u square root u be algebraically simplified? Well, so u times the square root of u, well, that's u multiplied by u to half. And when things have the same base, what do? You add exponents. You add exponents. So that's u to 1 plus half. So 3 halves. So, this is antiderivative of u to 3 halves minus 5 u to half du. And so now we can invoke the power rule multiple times, right? Power rule for u, power rule for u. So this would be, yes, u to 5 halves.
Can we factor out that 5?
I'm not sure what you're asking.
We can factor out that 5.
Well, I'll just leave the 5 here because it's a constant multiple. And so then this would be u to 3 halves divided by 3 halves. And plus a constant. And then is this the answer?
No.
No, it's not the answer. So this would be what? X plus 5 to 5 halves divided by 5 halves minus 5 X plus 5 to 3 halves over 3 halves. Plus a constant. Any question about this one? Any question about this one? So what we're doing, I haven't said it out loud, but now I'll tell you the general thing that we're doing. Is that there is a procedure that is the formal procedure for computing all antiderivatives. Okay, so like there are computer programs that compute antiderivatives. And you're probably aware of some, like for example Wolfram Alpha, right? So if you haven't heard of that, you should look it up, right? It's pretty terrific. Wolfram Alpha, you could type essentially any antiderivative into it and it'll just do it like instantaneously. That's great, except for when you're having a proctored quiz, right? Then Wolfram Alpha is not there for you. Okay, but at any rate, Wolfram Alpha and all the other machines that perform antiderivatives, how are they doing it? Right? There's no magic in there, right? They don't have illicit magic Wolfram Alpha. No, what Wolfram Alpha is doing is performing something called the Riesz procedure. And what we're doing is we're slowly going through the steps of the Riesz procedure. So the very first step in the Riesz procedure is you ask yourself, self, is this one of the antiderivatives in the list that I know? So is it one? Okay, if it's not, then can I perform any algebraic operations until it is one of the ones in the list that I know? And if not, then I'll try a substitution. And if not, then a list of other things that we're going to go over as the semester proceeds. Okay, good. So how about this one? Please evaluate e to the 4x divided by e to the 4x plus 9 dx antiderivative. The middle one. Okay, so let's write. So we have three known antiderivatives. U to the n du, 1 over u du, and e to u du. So those are the only three that we know. So what do you think about this? What do you want to try? So, there's only three possibilities. Only three. Sorry?
No.
You want to try E to U. Okay. If we're going to use this one, then what would U be? It'd have to, if it's going to be, if you, if we're going
to
use this one, the only thing that U could be is 4x because it's E and the whole exponent is U. So the exponent here is U, the exponent here, or sorry, the exponent here is 4x and the exponent here is 4x. This plus 9 is not in the exponent. So we could try that. What's the worst thing that could happen? We waste some time. So. So if U is 4x, then what's du?
4.
Not 4.
4 dx.
4 dx. Okay. So does that take care of much? So let's see, what would that do? So we could say du divided by 4 is dx. And if we were to do that, then the antiderivative would become e to u over e to u plus 9 and then du over 4. And I claim that this one is really no better than what we began with. I'd also like for you to observe that we were able to establish that in about 1 minute. Right? If I wasn't up here jabbering, then we could have done it in 30 seconds. Right? So it's not a big loss to have just tried and seen. Okay, so let's try something else.
The middle one.
The middle one. Okay, so if we're going to try the middle one, so this, you know, maybe not this one. Okay, so let's try something else. How about we try u is what?
E to
4x
plus 9.
Okay, so e to 4x plus 9. And then du is what?
E to the 4x plus 4 dx.
Yes, e to 4x multiplied by 4 dx. Well, okay, do we have, if we're saying u is the whole denominator, do we have another e to 4x hanging around?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do we have a dx hanging around?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, but this 4, that's messing everything up.
We just divide that.
Okay, so you're recommending that we say du by 4 is e to 4x dx. Well, if I take the original antiderivative and I rewrite it just a little bit and say that this is 1 over e to 4x plus 9 and multiplied by e to 4x dx, then is this what we wanted? Is that going to do what we wanted?
Yeah.
Yeah, that does it, right? So, specifically, we're saying that this is going to become u, and this is going to become du over 4. Any question about coming to this conclusion? And I'd like to point out that if I wasn't up here jabbing away, I could have tried both of these probably on the order of 3 minutes or less. Okay, it could have happened. Okay, so if we do that, then it will be antiderivative 1 over u multiplied by du over 4. And then, oh, this is one of the ones that we know, right? It's 1/4 times what? The log 1. So this would be 1/4, yes, log absolute, and then what is u? E to 4x plus 9. Okay, now, I personally don't care about the next thing I'm about to say, but I have to say it because it's all over YouTube and my math lab and everywhere else. Notice that 9 is positive. Okay? And e to 4x, how about that?
Positive.
It also is positive. The exponential of positive things is positive. The exponential of 0 is 1, which is positive. The exponential of negative things is also positive. That means that this term inside of the argument inside of the absolute value is greater than 9. Because it's 9 plus something greater than 0. So the argument to the absolute value is positive. So that means that we can drop the absolute value. So let's be careful about that. So on hand graded assignments, it doesn't matter. I don't care. Okay. On my math lab, okay, my math lab is gonna care. Yeah, it can be a little picky.
So when do we keep the absolute value?
You can drop the absolute value in this specific case because the thing you're putting in the absolute value is greater than 9. So that's why you can drop the absolute value. If the thing, so here's an example. The absolute value of x minus 3, say. Could you drop the absolute value here?
No.
No, you couldn't. Because if you plugged in x is 1 or 2, then you'd have 2 minus 3 is negative. And that's not the same. So you can't drop the absolute value because x minus 3 is not always positive. However, this e to 4x plus 9 is always positive.
So if it was x plus 9?
You could not do it.
Because x could be negative.
Because x could be negative million. And then x plus 9 would be negative.
Because both of those have to be positive.
Yes, both of these terms, 9 and e to 4x, are positive. So their sum is positive. Other questions? Okay. Good. Let's do a word problem because that'll be fun. Okay, so I'm going to read it out loud. First, a company has found that the marginal cost in. Such joy in the crowd. A company has found that the marginal cost in thousands of dollars to produce X central air conditioners is given by this following totally unrealistic function. Okay. Find the cost function. Okay. So we need to back up just a little bit to make sure everybody knows these words. So marginal cost. So if I give you a cost function, what is the marginal cost function?
The derivative.
It's the derivative. Right? It's the derivative. So you learned that in calculus one. So in business reckoning, marginal cost is the cost, if you're selling discrete things, is the cost of producing one more. Right? So if you're in the business of making TVs, then the marginal cost is the cost of making one more TV. Okay? So that's a discrete case. So that's the change, right? So in the continuous case, when you have a continuous variable, like you're making gallons of water or something like that, where it's continuous, right? You can make half a gallon, you can make whatever. So in that case, now you need the instantaneous rate of change is the marginal of it. So in business and economic reckoning, the word marginal is equivalent to derivative. Okay? So the question is asking, essentially, if I give you a marginal cost function, how do you get the cost function?
The antiderivative.
Yes. Is if I give you a marginal cost function, the derivative of the cost.
Okay.
How do you find the cost? With antiderivative, right? You have to undo the differentiation procedure, the marginality or whatever, I don't know. Okay, good, I like that. Okay, so a company has the following marginal cost. Function given by C prime of X is 60x divided by 5x squared plus E. Yeah, E. Which is why this is totally unrealistic, right? Really? That number showed up right there, just like that. Okay. So the marginal cost is this. The fixed cost is 10,000. Okay, the fixed cost is 10,000. So the instruction is to find cost, C of X. So here's another bit of jargon that you need to know from business reckoning. What is the meaning of fixed cost? Yeah, it's when the number of things that you are producing is zero. Right? So for example, you could think of this school as a business, to some extent it is. If we were teaching no courses whatsoever, we'd still need to run the air conditioners because buildings without air conditioning mold and succumb to the elements quite quickly. So even if we weren't teaching any classes whatsoever, you still have to run the air conditioner. Or a grocery store that's not open in the middle of the night nevertheless needs to run the refrigerators because otherwise their stuff is going to spoil. That's the fixed cost. So the fixed cost, as an equation, what does this mean? If I say the fixed cost is 10,000, what is that telling us? What is it? Okay, not C of zero, right? C of zero is 10,000. So now, do you remember the question that we did at near the end of last time? Near the end of last time we called it an initial value problem if you're a science major, or a Cauchy problem if you're a math major. Remember?
Yeah.
Good. The very last thing was a joke. Okay, so let's do this.
I wouldn't have written that down.
So the cost function, C of X, is the antiderivative of the derivative of the cost function. Okay? So this will be antiderivative of 60x divided by 5x squared plus E dx. So we need to compute this antiderivative. What do you think? What's that?
Let's make U.
The bottom?
5x plus E.
5x squared, right? Good.
Can we not do it for the whole thing?
No, because E's a number.
Yeah, E's just a constant, so we want to use it. So 5x squared plus E. I don't follow your...
On the last problem, we did E to the 4x plus 9, we put U in there for it.
Because E here would be like A or C or
E. E is a number. E is 2.7. I'm sorry?
But 9 is a number in the same instance in the last problem.
It doesn't necessarily mean like...
Oh, I see what you're doing.
Okay.
I thought you said you're just doing 5x squared.
No. Okay, good. So now we're on the same page. Okay. So then what's du then? 10x.
dx.
Okay. So do we have 10x dx?
No.
No. But we do have this x dx. So we could say du by 10 is x dx. Okay, so then now, what we're saying then, if we do this substitution, is that this red part will be substituted with u, right? The green is going to be substituted with du by 10. But what about 60?
Just keep them on the other side.
Right. So for those of you that are worried about 60, right, well, what will 60 be equal to when x is 12? What will 60 be equal to when x is 12?
60.
What will 60 be equal to when dinosaurs are walking around?
60.
Okay, good. So in particular, I'd like for you to observe that 60 really doesn't care about x and u at all. Okay, so then it requires no substitution at all. But I find that I have to say that, otherwise students get a little concerned. Yes. So 60 and then over u and then du over 10. Okay, so now 60 over 10, that's 6. It can be factored out. So now 1 over u du. And then is this one of the three antiderivatives that we know?
Yes.
What a coincidence. Okay, so then 6 log absolute value of 5x squared plus e. Okay, and you can't write plus c.
Oh, why not?
Why can you not write plus c?
Because it's 10,000, right?
No, it's not 10,000.
Oh, it's k.
Why k?
Because it's a word problem. Whatever.
you can write K. K is fine. Why can you write K but not C?
Oh, because it's a
C is a derivative
function. Yeah, we already used C.
Right, yeah.
You know, there's a person in real life named George Foreman. Okay? And he has on the order of 10 offspring, all of whom are called George. Females included. Okay? Not that there's anything wrong with that. But they're all called George. You can't name everything George. You can't do that. It's the same thing here. Okay, you can't name everything C. Did you have a question?
So in this instance, we could actually remove the absolute value as well, correct?
Yes. Why could you drop the absolute value?
Because any number you put in there that's negative is always going to come out positive. In the square root,
right.
The e is always positive.
Good. So we could say C of x. Okay. Now, have we answered the question?
Oh, sorry.
No.
We haven't answered the question. What have we not answered?
We didn't read the whole thing, so I'm not sure.
Well, have we found the cost function?
We found the cost function.
We haven't.
Why not?
No, because we haven't solved for k, so we have to plug in the 10,000.
Right, but k is not 10,000.
No, that's what we're solving.
No, but we know what c of x is.
Okay,
c
good.
Of x, wait. Is it c at 0?
Yes.
10,000.
So now we need to determine k.
Yes.
Okay, we're almost done, so I just need your attention for one more minute.
One minute.
T 10,000 is what you should get when you plug in C, when you plug in X is 0. So 10,000 is 6 log, and then when you plug in 0 into that, you get E, which is why the author of the question put E there. Why is that convenient? Because the log of E is 1, right? So this is just 6 plus K. And so 9994 is K. Yes. So the cost function is 6 log 5x squared plus E plus 9994. Terrific. Okay. Have a nice whatever day this is. Don't forget that the exam, the quizzes are on Saturday. Due Saturday.
They're on Saturday. We're all going on Saturday.